On April 15th this year, the Jehovah's Witnesses are planning on meeting in person at their Kingdom Halls to celebrate the death of Jesus Christ and have a meal prepared that almost all of the membership will not partake. It's the unleavened bread representing Jesus' body and wine that represents his blood. But this number of partakers seems to always grow each year that I can remember being a Jehovah's Witness. Jehovah's Witnesses like the annual memorial at the Kingdom Hall because they bring in a lot of money. A lot who attend are not JWs but feel they want to make a donation. So that's a lot of money they would not normally collect. It used to be that all the early founders and members of the Jehovah's Witnesses were considered anointed by God. Then later you had to be either from that original group of Bible students turned JW, or from that generation before 1935 to be considered anointed by God. As many may know, only a select few of anointed ones are allowed to partake of the emblems. There are no written rules on who may be deemed anointed by God to partake, but it is a society of men who will determine this. In the congregations through the years that I attended, we had a few anointed ones, and one was my aunt. But these were older people, not young, so they were generally accepted in the hall as anointed. There are a variety of reasons why this society cut off the anointed class as a closed group. The rest of us commoners are of the great crowd. To put it in simple, non-biblical terms, the reason is the anointed wanted to be the lofty leaders, with the rest of us rank and file being deemed the great crowd or the worker bee class, the slaves to the anointed class, and we do their bidding, whatever that may be. The ruling class of this organization constantly change the rules, they change Bible doctrine and their policies, and us worker bees have to obey or be thrown out of the corporation. But today, they still need that working class of Jehovah's Witnesses, so basically anyone becoming a baptized JW are of the worker bee class, and the lofty anointed class are few and far between. Okay, so let's say you want to be considered anointed in the JW congregation. You're tired of doing a lot of work for the congregation. You may or not care to move up in the ranks to be an elder, but you want an easier time of it in the hall and be considered the resident holy of holies in the congregation. It's just a status symbol, and you still hear ex-Jehovah's Witnesses say how they were anointed or a family member was in the anointed class as if that makes them special even after leaving the organization. Like I said, one of my aunts was anointed, and an uncle by marriage was also anointed who's a member of our family, and there are a few still around the country that still are considered anointed. Okay, so generally here are the steps so you too can be anointed, and this goes really for brothers or sisters. First, you come up with some bullshit story about how you had a vision from God or Christ, and if you're married, take a lot of time and contemplation and think about studying and hovering over that Bible and sleep a lot, and your spouse will ask what's wrong, and you can reveal your crisis of conscience and that you had a vision of being anointed by Christ. Walk around holy and miss a few days of work for emphasis. If you're not married, you can still do the same routine. Your friends will ask what's wrong with you, and you can slowly reveal the vision you had of being anointed by Christ. Now, the younger you are, the more difficult this will be to sell to the elders. If you stick to your conviction, be humble about it, act like it's a struggle, they should leave you alone with your belief. If you're an older person, this will be easier on you, since the elders will view you as being too old to make a difference anyway. Since the older ones are normally given an easier time of it, they can't really put them to work like they can a young person. Finally, well before the memorial, you must ask to meet with the elders to reveal you are anointed. They will normally have a laugh about it, but you need to stick to your guns if this is what you want. You cannot just walk into the JW Memorial and start partaking of the emblems. You will be marked and considered a threat to their peaceful world, and you will face being disfellowshipped. This has happened in one of my cousin's Kingdom Halls. The guy was disfellowshipped and ended up being forced out of the organization for good, which was actually good for him in the long run to not be tied to the JW religion. So, if you want to stay in the organization for whatever reason, then be humble about proclaiming you're anointed and quietly stick to your conviction. If you don't care and your goal is eviction, then go ahead and be an asshole and claim you're anointed and guzzle that wine, eat all that unleavened bread, and believe me, that will be your last memorial. You'll be out of the organization in no time. Basically, being anointed means you can be more relaxed and not worry about your hours in field service or doing anything in the Kingdom Hall. The ones I knew hardly did a damn thing in the hall. They gave really good answers when they raised their hand to comment, sometimes paraded to someone's Bible study. But basically, this field ministry work is for us worker bee class. So, if you want to be anointed in the JW world, take it slow, make a plan, stick with it. If you want to be ousted into fellowship, then be bold and rude about it, and you don't need to worry about getting a one-way ticket out of the organization. But if your goal is just sit back and relax, then get your friends and family to support your anointing. Then you show up at the Kingdom Hall for the memorial and humbly partake while the others in the congregation judge you and gossip about you when they get home. Us sisters used to view the memorial as our Oscar night. We would buy new outfits, try to outdo the next sister with her hair and makeup. If you're single, you look around the crowded Kingdom Hall to see if any cute guys showed up. The worldly guys were always attractive with their shaggy, long, wavy hair. They looked fit and trim since they didn't spend their lives sitting and reading the Watchtower 24/7. They actually had real jobs. And then after the memorial, groups would take off to socialize afterwards. So, for our family, my dad was an elder. We would meet at a pizza parlor with another elder family, talk about how wonderful that memorial was. Sometimes we'd see a few of those apostates holding up signs in the distance, and we pitied their ignorance of leaving God's true organization. Yes, JWs have very big egos. When I was one of them, we all thought we were special, and the world was stupid and ignorant, and we couldn't wait for everyone to die but us. I think if a person is curious, they can look online at some of the videos on the JW's memorial service or go yourself in person. You'll find it boring, and then when you go home, and you'll just feel empty inside, like the society is. It's just empty, with the membership pouring money into those contribution boxes and sending monthly donations to the organization online, but it's all empty promises that are never fulfilled. Now, for a friendly warning about those who have left the society, yet still feel the need to attend the JW Memorial Service year after year, either in person or now by Zoom, take a look at why you still feel the need to attend. What is drawing you to do this year after year, even though you're no longer a JW or perhaps never were one? Is the Spirit binding you to this ritual each year? Think twice before attending and proceed with caution.